As I read in the newspapers, the Republicans had a really interesting choice that they made. They had four individuals to choose between. They had the first female speaker of the Missouri House of Representatives, a former United States attorney, a lawyer and a politician of significance and renown in this state. And they said no, they tossed her out. They had a three-time lieutenant governor of this state to choose between, and the individual who brought, in two terms in the Missouri Senate, brought the Republicans to power in that chamber, and they tossed him out. They had a businessman who built a $250 million business in our state, employed thousands and thousands of people, and they tossed him out.
It's okay.
And they chose, this is a very interesting situation as to what is going on in our state. And they chose a motivational speaker, a professional motivational speaker with a machine gun who pledges to blow this government up.
What?
This is the blow it up wing of the Republican Party has now taken over the Republican Party. And I have watched this individual now, Eric Greitens, work for the last 6 months, and I take him at his word that he is capable of blowing the government up. But I have no confidence whatsoever that he has the experience or the knowledge how to put it back together when he does.
Right.
That is what. The blow it up wing of the Republican Party now speaks for the Republican Party, but goodness, it cannot possibly speak for all Missourians. Government is a synonym for the word cooperation, and they have declared war on cooperation. This cannot be our future, and this is so important. What this election is about, as everybody knows, I was, 9 years ago, I was the leader of the Republicans in the Missouri Senate, and I am now a proud Democrat and a proud conservative Democrat because I believe, thank you, because I firmly believe that fiscal conservatism and social tolerance can live together in this state, and that the vast majority of Missourians want fiscal conservatism and social tolerance to live together in our state, and that is what we are going to do. That is what we are working for. And today we had maybe one of the most historic examples in the history of this state that this dream is possible. About 3 hours ago, the Missouri Farm Bureau, one of the most conservative organizations in the state of Missouri that has spoken for rural agriculture since 1915, for the first time in the history of this organization, the first time in 100 years, endorsed a Democrat for governor in the state of Missouri. I'm incredibly grateful and moved by this act of outreach. It's one thing, as these politicians know, to reach a handout across the aisle. It's another thing to get a hand back.
Yeah.
And so I don't take this lightly at all. And rallying this Democratic Party, who for so many years in the state of Missouri spoke articulately on behalf of agriculture in our state, and bringing those words and those actions, those deeds back, and trying to unify this state is really what this campaign is about. One of the things that makes me saddest about politics in the state of Missouri right now is that the two parties largely have separated into two geographic camps. Kip is an exception, Stephen is an exception, of course, but the Democratic Party has become too associated with the urban centers, and the Republican Party too exclusive in the rural territories. It's not the way we should be. It's not the Missouri that we know. And this is an example. Today's action is an enormous example that it is possible to bring people back together. This election pits the blow it up party against the bring it back together party. Mm-hmm. so important. Let's talk about two things. First, let's talk about education. The high water mark for public higher education in the state of Missouri was Bob Holden's budget of 2001. Since that time, the majority in the General Assembly has cut higher education, which has dramatic effect on this town, by 40%. Institutions like Northwest Missouri State University that used to receive 75% of their operating revenue from general revenue, from state government, now receive 25%. And that decline has occurred over 15 years. Well, folks, it can't go on for another 15 years because then the universities will be paying us if they want to stay open. This group values higher education so little that they are extrapolating this curve right down to zero. They are getting us out of the higher education business, and Missourians don't even know it because it's been like a lobster boiling in a pot. It's just year by year by year. And then you look back over a 15-year period and you see the devastation that has occurred. You see how deep they have dug the hole. That's higher education. How about K-12? They cut $500 million out of the K-12 budget just a few months ago. $500 million. In 1993, Mel Carnahan, you were there, right, Roger?
There.
1993, Roger Wilson, Mel Carnahan, and others, bipartisan group in the Missouri legislature, made a historic commitment to K-12 in the education of the state. And you know what? The state felt good about it. Democrats and Republicans felt good about it. And it lasted exactly until the Republican takeover in 2001. If Mel Carnahan was alive today, and Mel Carnahan's foundation formula, the public school funding formula that was built in 1993, if that funding formula was still in place today, the appropriation this year for K-12 education in the state of Missouri would be $4.5 billion. But it was not $4.5 billion when the budget was finalized a couple of months ago. It was $3.2 billion. That is a 25% erosion. That is what has occurred under leadership that year by year has been boiling the lobster and strangling the government. And what happens when public education is starved like this? Well, these public school districts, 514 of them, 514 school districts in the state of Missouri, the first thing they do is they cut BAM. And after they cut BAM, the next year they need to cut art and drama. And after art and drama, it's teacher quality. And we see in districts like St. Louis and Kansas City and down in the Boot Hill, greater and greater numbers of substitute teachers, uncertified teachers, who are sitting in classrooms essentially babysitting. They are not certified to teach in Missouri classrooms, and yet with increasing numbers, they are the ones there instead of certified teachers because these districts cannot afford the teacher salaries that they need. And after you go through band and art and drama and then teacher quality, then what you get to is things like Fridays. There are now 15 school districts in the state of Missouri that no longer attend school on Fridays because they can't afford to. And these school districts came to the state legislature about 3 or 4 years ago and said, look, either give us more money or we can't stay open on Fridays. You'll have to change the law. And they said, okay, we'll change the law. You can go to school 4 days a week. When we live in a globalized economy where we are training these youngsters up for international competition in a knowledge economy, and our solution, our strategy as Missourians is to cut the foundation formula by 25% and allow our children to go to school 4 days a week, my fellow Missourians, we have reached a gut check moment. And we have to question the wisdom of our leadership in the Missouri General Assembly that has allowed this to occur. Let me touch on one other thing before we go. Healthcare. Every year, the federal government is sending the Missouri State Legislature a check for $2 billion. And our leadership in Jefferson City is taking that $2 billion check and ripping it up into little pieces and then putting it in the toilet and flushing it down. uncashed. Now, our state general revenue budget is $8 billion. So I say that so you can proportion that a $2 billion check is not insignificant. It's a hell of a lot of money. Now, why do they do this? They do this because they are beating their chest in order to send a political signal of pride to a gentleman who is only going to occupy the White House for another 4 or 5 months anyway, that they do not like the way he passed the Affordable Care Act all the way back in 2010. But this political pride that they feel, this chest thumping, I know that it makes them feel good. They tell me it makes them feel good. But it does not, it has not helped health care in our state. The pride that they feel did not keep open the hospital in Osceola, nor did it keep open the hospital in Mount Vernon, nor did it keep open the hospital in Farmington, nor the one in Reynolds County, nor the adjoining clinic, all of which closed in the last 30 months or so, because the funding of healthcare in our country has changed post-2010. And there will be more rural hospitals that close in the coming months. It's unstoppable. This pride will not keep open our hospitals. Rural Missouri is losing a hospital every 8 months. But what would keep open rural hospitals? $2 billion a year. $2 billion a year invested in Missouri healthcare. When a farmer in our state strokes out in his combine in St. Clair County, there's a clock that starts ticking. His wife has 60 minutes. First, she's got to find him. Think about that. She's got to go out in the field and find him. Then she needs to contact an emergency crew to get him to an emergency room, get a needle stuck in his arm, and have TPA injected into his bloodstream and up to his brain in the hopes of loosening that clock. If she beats that clock, that old boy will be back in his combine in 3 weeks. Mm-hmm. If she doesn't beat the clock, then he's going to spend the rest of his life in the third bedroom. When leaders in Jefferson City elevate their own political pride over that woman's well-being, over that county's healthcare system, over life in rural Missouri, they are making life in rural Missouri harder. Mm-hmm. And they should be held accountable. This one counts. If you care about women's health care, this election counts. If you care about the Missouri Non-Discrimination Act, this one counts. If you care about equal pay for equal work, this one counts. If you care about about keeping right to work out of this state, and about not letting and about not turning a bunch of $11 an hour workers who were there because of collective bargaining into $9 an hour workers, which is what they'll become if they don't have collective bargaining, this one counts. There's over in St. Louis, there's a warehouse, a Teamster warehouse in Baldwin, it's in South County, that is closing. It is a union warehouse, $24 an hour workers. It is closing, and the business, I don't need to name them because I'm not into personalizing these things. It's a well-known business, however. The business is moving the warehouse to the Northport area up by the airport and is reopening as a non-union shop. And as best as we can tell, they are not allowing the workers who were laid off in the South County area to apply up in the North County area. $24 an hour, $11 an hour. That is what collective bargaining means. That is the protection that 75 years of collective bargaining has brought this country. Before 1935, human beings were just traded like cattle and corn. They were just another commodity in this country. Franklin Roosevelt gave all of us, and our fathers, and our grandmothers, and everybody else, gave us two rights. They gave us the minimum wage and the right to collectively bargain. And since that time, the middle class has spawned in this country, and it has changed and stabilized this country for 75 years. Same people who love right to work, typically the same people who are against the minimum wage. There's an amazing coincidence between these two groups of people. This one counts. It counts for the Democratic Party. For all of us just keeping our voice in the process. So I ask you, over the next 95 days, to work with these two candidates over here, make sure they are returned to the House, make sure this incredible young man is delivered into the Missouri Senate, where he will be in But most importantly, that we preserve the notion that this is a state where fiscal conservatism and social tolerance can exist at one place. We are not going to give this state over to the blow it up crew. The Bring It Back Together crew is gonna win, and gonna win big. Thank you, everybody.